Students and faculty of SPJN Institute of Management Research who are here with us for ET Explains event in Mumbai. Our topic today is, will Modi's big gamble of demonetization work? We also welcome our online viewers who have joined us live on economictimes.com and ET.com Facebook live session. So let's get on with the event today. I would like to introduce you to our editor panel. On the left is R. Sriram, resident editor, Economic Times. Next to him is Shagata Ghosh, associate editor. Third from the left is Nishant Vasudevan, markets editor. And on your extreme right is Dr. Narendranathan, chief manager investments, ET Wealth. The panel will be taking questions from the audience once we finish with the debate. We also request our online viewers to tweet their questions using hashtag ETExplains. Also, the audience here can tweet their questions using the hashtag ETExplains. So without wasting much time, over to you, Sriram, to start the moderate.
Thank you, Divya. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Thanks, SPJN, the faculty and the students for agreeing to host us here on this lovely evening. Winter evenings are always lovely in Bombay, isn't it? And this lovely campus as well. Let me just add one particular qualify a little bit of what Divya said. The gentleman who is seated on your extreme right, Dr. Narendranathan, about 5-6 months ago wrote a column in our paper, the Economic Times, where he said that it's time for the government to withdraw the 500 rupees and 1,000 rupee notes. And ever since the decision was announced on November 8th, Dr. Nathan has become a buzzword on social media. He's become a social media star. He's become a TV star. One big round of applause to him. Thank you. Thank you very much. ET Explains is, as my colleague Divya also said, is a very select elite panel forum where ET editors participate and engage with a select audience and discuss issues of very topical importance. And there is nothing that can be more topical than the topic, than the subject that we are going to discuss today. Demonetization. Will Modi's big gamble work or will it be bust? Now, the audience panel has already been introduced, but let me just start this whole discussion with a small story, a small anecdote. I'm sure all of you love hearing a story, except especially from old journalists like us. About 25 years ago, a certain reporter was traveling down the streets of Bombay, and it so happened that he was going down the Mint Street, the street where RBI is located. And he happened to see, this was 25 years ago, not much traffic on the roads, right? And you don't have this plethora of cars and you can't miss anything. So he saw the RBI gates open and he saw a phalanx of security trucks coming out, and not ordinary trucks, right? Not the Tata Ashok Leyland trucks, but big real security trucks coming out, followed by police escort and guards and all that. And his curiosity was immediately aroused. I said, what is going on here? I mean, why is on a very dull day when nothing really is happening, why is there this big phalanx of security trucks coming out of RBI? He followed the trucks. He dropped everything that he did. He followed the trucks, and it all went all the way to the airport. Now, this gentleman was very, very curious. What is really going on? He came back, and he made a few phone calls, and it didn't take him long to figure out that what has happened was something very, very momentous in India's economic history. And I'm sure you all know what it was. Anybody? Yep, the pledging of gold. The pledging of gold, which set the stage for a raft of economic reforms. That time it was the Chandrasekhar government and then the Narasimha Rao government, which completely changed the face of Indian economy, India Inc. and everything. On November 8th, this year, 2016, a lot of things happened in secret. But instead of a journalist snooping around RBI headquarters, you had the Prime Minister coming out and saying, well, this is what we did. It probably, will it be as revolutionary as what happened in 1991? Maybe not, or maybe it will. Will it be a bust? Will it have? Will the government end up having egg on the faces of on its faces, given the fact that you're still having huge queues outside, and that is Bombay? You don't know when you're going outside Bombay in the villages what the situation is. So to discuss all these issues, we have this panel. Let me just give you a little bit of a heads up about how we're going to do it. 40 minutes of discussion, and I hope the discussion will not be boring. We'll keep it as bright and as lively as possible. Followed by 40 minutes of question answer time. And let's make this as interactive as possible. Are you guys all excited?
Yes.
Yeah? How many of you stood in queues outside? How many of you got money? How many of you didn't get? Oh, the guys who didn't get money a lot. So maybe, I don't know which way this is going to go. But let me start with Sugato. Sugato, short-term pain, long-term benefit, short-term disaster, long-term disaster. In your view, how do you sum it up?
Well, to begin with, on the evening of November 8, the question that struck me was that, is this the need of the hour? Because why should a government which is pursuing serious reforms on the verge of enacting landmark legislations do something as unsettling as this? Because if you're pushing through demonetization of this magnitude in an economy as diverse as India, you're taking three primary risks. One is the political risk, because if the hardships continue, the wage losses happen, people will go restless, more and more people will question the decision. Number two is the fiscal risk. You really can't quantify what would be the fiscal gain of the government and whether in future black money would stop. And third, the more unstated risk, but a risk nonetheless, is the monetary policy challenge. There is the banks are inundated with deposits. Some of it will flow out. There is an upheaval in the bond market, in the equity market. The international markets are absolutely nervous after Trump came in. Now, in this kind of a situation, was the timing right? And why now? Because you are exposing yourself to a lot of risks. That was the first thing I had in mind.
Bad timing?
That's timing is definitely bad, but right. I have certain fundamental difference sure. on the demonetization itself,
sure.
on the policy itself.
Yeah. Nishant? Bad timing, Sugato says, markets are down. US markets are up. Everybody said that after Trump comes in, it'll all be, you know, mayhem. But the US markets are up, but all markets are down. So really bad timing, isn't it?
Yeah, I'll talk from the market's perspective. The consensus is that it is short-term gains and long-term pain, or rather, short-term pain and long-term sure. gains. But nobody really knows what is short-term. Is it 6 months? Is it 9 months? Is it 12 months? People are sure that there's going to be a slowdown in corporate earnings growth and in economic growth. But the biggest damage that the government has done through demonetization is it has hit consumption. Consumption has been the strongest growth driver for the Indian economy and the corporate earnings in the last maybe 3 or 4 years. Investment is just not happening. It is maybe 55-60% of the capacity.
Right.
And there are no exports also. There is, but nothing sure. worth talking about. So now the problem is with consumption also hit, what is the next growth driver? There's nothing to look forward to. So now, you know, the government spin doctors might argue that, you know, that the markets are falling because of the external circumstances,
right.
which is Trump and other things. But that is just the Sensex and the Nifty, the blue chips.
Right.
What about the small and mid caps, where a lot of stocks had already risen? I mean, they were trading at multiples at as high as 50 and 70 times.
Right.
Many of them are crumbling. So the market, the government has really taken a gamble in that sense. Markets are falling, but the timing of it is a bit of a problem.
So timing is bad once again, and it's going to hit consumption, it's going to hit earnings, it's going to slow down the economy. So overall, it looks to be a very, very bad, negative decision with a lot of very negative consequences for the government and for the economy. Say 6 months down the line, maybe even 1 year down the line. Doc, if I can come to you, you wrote that piece and you said that this is a way to get rid of black money.
Yeah.
Now, the government has done this, but there is a lot of collateral damage.
Yeah, government has done it, but not the way we were expecting to do it.
Sure.
Basically that...
What do you think they should have done better?
Yeah, I think that government should have printed much more 100 rupee notes, flooded the system with that before withdrawing these 500,000 rupee notes.
Right.
And again, introducing 2,000 rupee notes. So it is, you are withdrawing 1,000 rupee notes and coming out with 2,000 rupee notes. So that impact on black money, it will be shorter.
Right.
It's going to come back again. Maybe once things settle, people will start storing black money again in 2,000 rupee notes. It will be easier for them to do it.
Right.
Then their thing of what we are thought at that time or thinking was that since there is a huge increase in money supply and everything, now it is 86%. At that time when I wrote it,
sure,
close to 80%. It's in 500,000 rupee notes. If you withdraw that and flood the system with 100 rupee notes,
right,
then more and more people will be forced to shift to from cash to maybe banking channels, maybe check, maybe debit card, credit card, Paytm, whatever it may be, mobile wallet. So that was the thing. So now there's a short time pain. If you have flooded the system earlier with itself with 100 rupee notes, the pain would have been lesser. Yeah. Now there is a pain and we don't know when the pain will end.
Right. But let me ask you a counter question here. If the government had the option of printing all these notes in complete total secrecy before, they would have probably done it. The fact that they didn't do it, could it have been because of the fact that, well, you know, they were afraid the news would leak out?
No, I think the introduction of 2000 rupee notes itself was that decision.
Right.
Itself was created into that problem of leaking the notes. So if you just again assume that they are coming out with the 500,000 rupee note itself,
right,
there is no curiosity. Since they are coming out 2000 rupee notes, there is a curiosity factor, and because of the curiosity factor, it started leaking.
Right.
As we all know, this started flowing around WhatsApp and other social media at least a week back.
Correct.
I have seen it.
Correct.
1 week back, that full 2000 rupee notes details and things
that's
like
right.
that.
That's right.
So that there is even, nobody has confirmed it, saying that because of that, government has preponed it. Instead of waiting for the full preparation, they preponed it.
They hurried
just
it
because
up
it is only leaked, we have to do something, we cannot wait it, otherwise the entire thing will be leaked out.
Right. But do you think that this is a decision that will go some way in combating black money, or is it just a short-term thing that
will help combating black money in short term?
In the short term.
Yeah.
And it will come back again after.
Come back again if government doesn't take other measures. Government is talking of maybe attacking Benami and gold and so many other things. If government tackle that, see
right.
that most of the black money is in three places, at least in India.
Right.
Real estate, gold and in cash.
That's right.
I'm not including this Swiss bank account and things like that. Right. So this, as of now, the attack is only on the black money in hard cash. Real estate and gold is still outside.
It's still out. Sure, Shugata, you have
no,
to
I'll just add to doctor's point. When you talk of planning, the planning is just not, I mean, don't think of planning just as building a stockpile of 100 rupee notes.
Right.
For instance, when you do demonetization, two things can happen.
Mm-hmm.
One is some money enters the banking system and some money which never enters the banking system.
Right.
Now, some money which enters the banking system, a lot of it, suppose, is black money. Then the government should have a mechanism to tax and penalize that black money.
Mm-hmm.
Because if those guys also end up paying 33% or 36% tax, as
right.
you and I are paying,
right.
then it's a travesty of justice.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, those guys must be paid a penalty, must be charged a penalty. Now, a finance ministry official said that they will impose a 200% penalty. But this was a statement in haste, because there is nothing in the law,
mm-hmm.
in the income tax law, which allows a 200% penalty. 200% penalty means if you get 1 crore, then 36% plus another 33, your 98%, 99% goes.
That's right.
Now, there is nothing in the law which can make it happen. Now, you can make that guy's life miserable by asking the enforcement directorate, invoking other harsh laws like anti-money laundering, to make him pay the tax, but that's not the way. Your legislation, for instance, if that legislation was in place
right.
before you had done that, maybe you would have been slightly more prepared.
Right.
And
right.
to begin with, you should have demonetized the 1,000 rupee notes, if at all. Why 500?
Why 500?
When a pack of cigarette costs 250 rupees. I mean, it's
absolutely
silly.
Very valid point. So, do you think that they will now come with a legislation to impose this 200% penalty now?
Well,
and backdate it.
That would be, you know, this government has gone on record saying that they don't want retrospective amendment. But at the same time, the Prime Minister has said that from November 8, these notes are delegalized, demonetized, legal tender.
That's right.
So they can say that, look, we guys have been warning you. This is not exactly the retrospective taxation of Vodafone. We are very much within our powers to impose 200%.
Mm-hmm.
Because unless they do that, there will be a plethora of litigations. And that won't really help you in getting the tax.
That's right.
Anyway, the tax will come next year, not this.
That's right. It'll all from 2017-18. Yeah. But Doc, if I can just bring you on this, there is a fair amount of legal challenges to what the government is doing. Cases filed in the High Court and the Supreme Court. Do you think those cases have a chance? Is the government really on a sound legal footing now, as far as this particular measure is concerned?
I think this is 100% under the coming under the executive decision.
Right.
Or even if the law has to be passed, as we are saying, it is coming under the judiciary, the legislature.
Right.
I don't think judiciary will block any of these events.
Right. I mean, it doesn't look as if they're going to do that. But then every day there are new cases being filed, and every day, as much as you see the queues being formed and see distress in rural areas.
Yeah, but at least the queues have started coming down. Once this 2,000 rupee notes have come to the system, queues have come down.
Right.
And 500 rupee notes also started reaching. Yesterday, right. I got some 500 rupee notes from my nearby ATM. Right.
Lucky man. You got 500 rupee notes.
Things have started coming in.
Yep.
Maybe once the 500 rupee notes also comes in, then the queues will go.
Then the queues will go away. Okay, that's good. But that's an important point. I'll just come back to the panel on that. But let me just, before that, take on one issue that Sugato raised, which is the issue of harassment, the issue of penalty. We've already seen news reports about how income tax officials are going after dwellers, they're going after builders. They're sending notices. In fact, there was a notice that was sent about cash deposits, asking people to explain. Come in person and explain, okay, how did you deposit so much in cash? Are we going to enter a period where we are going to see some kind of a return or some kind of a scenario of a raid Raj? Is that what is going to happen?
Well, to
unleash the income tax on...
I mean, to use the word tax terrorism, as they used to say during Mr. Chidambaram's time. The thing is that I wouldn't be surprised if there is a plethora of tax notice.
Mm-hmm.
Because all this, a lot depends on how much money comes into the banking system by 30th December.
Right.
Now, if a lot of money comes into the banking system,
mm-hmm.
in that case, a lot of money... Black money has entered the banking system.
Right.
Now, these guys who have deposited their black money,
mm-hmm.
it's difficult to believe that they have smilingly deposited their money, yeah. and are just exposing themselves to the wrath of the income tax department. Either that, or they have found a way to launder their money and they're depositing the cash and they're taking care of the right. tax system. Now, the government, besides bringing a lot of money into the banking system, the government also has to raise revenue, because it's also a political decision.
Right, of course.
Because unless you tax these guys,
yeah.
who are the holders of cash black money, then your purpose is defeated.
Yeah.
And if a lot of money, if a predominant amount of currency in circulation enters the banking system, then it will be a bit of a tricky situation for the government, mm-hmm. because in that case you don't know how to explain the situation.
Right.
In that case, the entire money has entered the thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is a lot of it black, or there was no black economy, or people have laundered the money and made it white?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
that is the thing. So December 30th or January 1st, whenever government releases the number,
right.
that is important.
That is important. That's an important point. But let me just quiz you on this a little further. 15 lakh crore is the estimate of 500 and 1,000 rupee notes. As of yesterday or as of today, we have about
17 lakh crore.
17 lakh crore, but of that...
17 lakh crore is total.
Is the total. 85%.
Right,
it's about 15 lakh
crore. Around right. is the
about 5.5 lakh crore has probably come into the system. According to you, what kind of progress are we going to see till about December 30th? I mean, you're
no,
going to see...
No, look, please understand. This is a temporary thing.
Mm-hmm.
There is a bulge in the bank deposits because there are severe restrictions on withdrawal.
Correct.
When these clamps are lifted, a lot of people will start withdrawing money. So the deposits will not look as robust,
as rosy as they are now.
So correct. That will also play out in the money market, because people, when they start withdrawing the deposits,
that's right.
again the ball needle will start going up.
It will start going up, that's right. Nishant, Ray yeah, Raj, yeah. are we looking at some kind of a scenario where income tax guys are going to go after builders, going after, and real estate is a big part of the market economy, of stock markets.
Yeah, especially. Yeah. So for the same reason why, that is the reason why all these stocks have fallen. But I just want to add to what Sugato sure. said about the bond yields. Bond yields have fallen to almost 6.5.
Less than 6.5.
Today, 6.3.
6.3.
Right.
You know, we are going to see a lot of volatility in the bond yields, because as of now, banks are flush with cash,
mm-hmm.
and a lot of the surplus cash, they are putting it in the bond market. Now, let's say that there are withdrawals, you know, then what happens? You know, will there be a lot of... So,
right.
market is already factoring in a scenario where, you know, bond yields are going to be maybe 6 or maybe even 5.75.
Right.
So, that is a bit scary at this...
That's a scary scenario.
Yeah.
Do you think, Nishant, given the kind of mayhem and havoc this has created in the last, say, couple of weeks, and the beating that the stock market has taken, today the Nifty has fallen below the 24th June Brexit low, so yeah. you're gone below that now. The government will come out with more SOPs, more rate cuts, maybe tax cuts, maybe a big push towards affordable housing, big push towards infrastructure, not just to revive the economy, but also revive stock market sentiment. Is that something that you expect?
Yeah. In fact, just one more point, you know, that sure. Markets in the last 8 days, they have erased all the gains that they made
in 2016. They made from, that's right.
I'm sure the government is noticing this, the impact of this on rupee. And so I get a feeling that immediately government is unlikely to do anything to prop up the economy.
Mm-hmm.
But I think one event that will be worth watching out for is the budget.
Correct.
This time the budget is going to be really different, because if the government does not announce anything significant in the budget, we are going to have a real mayhem in the market.
Real mayhem.
Yeah, absolutely.
What do you mean that the decline in private consumption should be compensated by the government?
By government spending. That is by the only way out. Because right. because nothing else is actually, we don't know the impact of demonetization on consumption.
That's
people
right.
say that, you know, it is going to decline by 20, 30, 40, 50%. So nobody has any estimate. So that is the reason why government is left with no other option but to prop up the economy.
Well, anecdotal evidence so far seems to suggest there is a big impact. It's yeah. just anecdotal. We yeah. don't have any data as yet.
Yeah.
But if the government were to do that, where is it going to get the money from? Shukato, raid the RBI, get them to transfer some of the results. You wrote about it yesterday.
No, well, that may not be as automatic as we think.
Mm-hmm.
That will take time. That will require legislations and other things.
Right.
But before that, since you mentioned RBI, Dr. Patel will have to present the monetary policy next month.
Correct.
So what he does, I mean, currently there is a widely shared perception that he has a sizable elbow room to cut rates.
Right.
Now, the Fed meeting is there. If the Fed rates go up,
which they are likely to,
and US rates are already going up.
That's right.
And if Indian rates again come below, the difference
is going to happen.
I mean, would have an impact on the bond market. So what, and also, this is the Rabi sowing season.
Correct.
So if food inflation also goes up,
right.
So one really doesn't know what, because it's, I think what people are not understanding or not writing about because of this cash chaos and everything happening, mm-hmm. the challenge for RBI is formidable. In fact, this is Dr. Patel's first
big test. So you think you are
saying, and everybody thought the test would come from abroad, but the test has come from within.
Yeah. That's a Modi surprise, so yeah. to say. Do you think there will be, he may not cut rates as much as expected? Because I think the markets are already pricing in a 50 basis point cut.
Well,
I mean, if he does 25, I'm sure they're going to be disappointed.
His stance has to be accommodative.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because there is a, everybody across the board would agree that there is a decline in consumption, so
right.
RBI cannot maintain.
Right.
Whether he can aggressively cut rates, I have my doubts. Because it's very important to know that to what extent the deposits stay as deposits and to what extent it goes back again as currency.
Right.
Now, people who withdraw currency, these are behavioral patterns.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you like to hold 20,000 cash every month, you suddenly can't change your...
Absolutely.
But it takes
Absolutely.
Time.
Absolutely.
So that currency with the public is a very structural thing. So it takes a long time to change.
Right.
So if that doesn't change dramatically, I mean, he won't have that. It would be erroneous to draw or to guess what RBI would do going by the flood of deposits that is happening
that it's
now.
Got just now. It may be temporary. I mean, that's a good point. But we'll come back to the points about what the RBI can do and what the government can do. Doc, I'm just going to come to you now. The measures, you mentioned about the measures that the government should take if black money doesn't go back into the system and become, you know, as big a problem as it is today. What do you think they're going to do next? Attack Benami property? Are they going to do,
even now itself, something which we are talking of, this tax terrorism kind of a thing,
right.
which is even sending notices, income tax department has already started.
Right.
We have seen something like 4.5 lakh, somebody deposited into a bank and they are sending notices
of course.
I think they are doing it with two purposes. One is maybe to make sure that more number of people don't deposit. So,
yes.
see that the thing is that out of this 15 lakh,
mm-hmm.
everything is not black. Maybe around 40% may be black.
Yeah.
And out of this 40, some at least 10, 15, 20, they will do some adjustments and they will convert into white and they deposit it.
Right.
So at least some 20-25% of the total money should not get into the banking system.
Right.
So that the government can show that this is success.
Right.
Sandeep Swartha says that if the entire money gets in, entire 15 lakh gets in, suddenly the government will be totally lost. They cannot explain why did he do all this.
That is probably not a very, you know, it's probably a remote possibility, isn't it? The entire 15 lakh probably may not get into the system because there is some amount of black. We don't know what it is.
But there is some amount of black and how much of that will be managed and invested through somebody else or find out some way. And even since the tax law is not very strict,
right,
you can just deposit it and declare it as your income in this quarter itself. So if they do it.
Mm-hmm. But is it so easy to do that now?
It is
given
not
the fact that the tax guys and the bank guys are watching it very, very carefully.
No, bank guys are watching, but you have the full right to do it now.
Right.
As per the income tax law, you have the right to do it and then declare it as the income for this year. Then yeah, there penalty cannot come.
I agree with him.
Yeah. So then maybe the like anti-money laundering act or maybe anti-corruption act, something government can harass. That is later, but as of now, as per income tax law, they can do it.
They can do it. Okay, one point which was actually mentioned in one of the newspapers, edit page pieces today, which raised this possibility that what if the income tax does not agree with your assessment that this is an income for this year, and what if they think that this is an income actually that you've hidden over the previous years and you actually try and reopen the earlier cases. Now, it's not a very done deal, right? I mean, you can't just say, all right, I have 10 crore with me and that's my income for this year and that's it, I'm paying 30% on it. It'll be very difficult to get away, I suppose.
Yeah, correct. That will go.
There'll be multiple litigation.
Yeah.
So that will end up into some cases and it will end up into some tax tribunal. So
that's right.
The government may not get the money immediately. After.
Right. So you think that this, well, we use the name surgical strike very often, that it's kind of overused and misused. I don't know whether there are any doctors out here and what they think about surgical strike. But do you think there's going to be any more measures coming? I mean, you talked about real estate. What about curbs on cash? We have the SIT report which says that you curb cash transactions beyond 3 lakh. Everything has to be done to...
Cash transaction above 50 is already restricted now. Yeah.
No, I'm not talking about this current scenario.
No, you just can't do it.
Yeah.
You can't have no transaction. They can... Cash can't change hands more than 3 lakhs. Mm. And you can't deposit more than 15 lakhs. PAN card or no PAN cards with a bank. Well, that is a SIT suggestion.
The SIT suggestion, that's right.
They can do it. I mean,
they can do it, but how will they implement it?
And any purchase about 2 or 2.5 lakhs, you need to submit your PAN card.
That is anyway there.
Yeah.
So is this, are we going to see a series of such strikes, stroke steps
against
black money?
There will be a series of measures. After this, I think government will wait till December end to see how this is panning out before coming out with more action. But there will definitely be more action.
There will definitely be more.
And if this becomes successful in the sense at least some 3 lakh crore or more doesn't get into the banking system, that gives them a huge success ratio, or at least they can trumpet saying that this is a
That is true. There is still some doubt about how the government can actually use it. And how the RBI can actually transfer it. I mean, I'm not an expert on central bank accounting, but I'm sure there are a lot of experts out there who can figure out as to how whether the RBI can actually transfer and how much profit can the government actually book. But coming back to this point about one of you mentioned this point about budget on February 1st, and that's really going to become very, very important as probably the 1991 budget or the 2001 budget or the 2009 budget. Nishant, what do you think the government should do in the budget to immediately ease the situation, to immediately set it right? I mean, they can't solve all problems, but what should they do according to you?
No. So the feedback that I'm getting from the market, from leading market participants, is that they're left with no other option but to announce some huge spending plans, right, especially on asset building.
Infrastructure,
yeah. So you have, they might announce, they might spend some amount on NREGA and Jandhan.
Right.
But the bigger thing will be on how much they're spending on infrastructure. If, let's say that majority of it is on infrastructure, then probably, then investors will be a little more relieved. All the concerns might be alleviated to some extent. But right. let's say that if majority, I mean, they are going, they are playing the populist card mm-hmm. of going more on Narega and Jandhan, mm-hmm. then we have a bit of a problem.
But you know, if I can just play the devil's advocate here,
yeah.
the last 2 years, yeah. they've been spending heavily on infrastructure. Mm-hmm. I mean, your railway, if you look at the plan, the capital expenditure plan, 8 lakh crore over 5 years, the big spending on roads hasn't really moved the needle. It's moved. It's done. It's done, pushed up cement production a little bit. Steel production has gone up a little bit. Railway, you're finally seeing the accident yesterday is a cruel reminder about the safety issues in our railways, but you're seeing some amount of action in terms of electrification and infrastructure building. So how much more infrastructure building can they announce? You know, how is it really going to move the needle?
True. So, I mean, as you very rightly said, it is hardly enough to move the needle. You mm-hmm. know, you need much more than this. You know, the country is big. There is so much of need for the government to spend more on the previous government. If you look at it, they were spending more on the social
That's
part
right.
of it.
Yeah.
Now there was a lot of money that was being spent on components where there was not much of assets that were being created.
Right.
Now. This is, I mean, they need to give a final push to kind of prop up the economy, as you say, you know, just to move the needle.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, it requires a lot.
It requires a big push,
yeah.
not just a small
we'll be,
push.
I mean, we'll be little over 2 years away from the general election.
Yeah. Right, right.
Last 7 years, it's wrong to blame on this government alone, but last 7 years, there has not been huge creation of jobs.
Right.
So I think the single biggest focus of the budget mm-hmm. and the government policies over the next 1 year would be job creation.
Yeah.
Because if you see this demonetization,
mm-hmm.
the two sectors demonetization would hit badly. One is jewelry and allied sectors
right.
and the construction and real estate,
right.
right, where cash handling happens. Now, these two sectors mm-hmm. contribute a huge amount in the GDP
yeah.
thing.
Yeah.
And also particularly real estate sector, I mean, huge, is a huge employer.
Right, absolutely.
So they have to do something which really creates jobs.
Yeah, but you know, there is a problem here. Now we are talking about going after Benami property. We are talking about measures to tackle black money and real estate. If you're really going to do all that, then the real estate sector is going to sink deeper into
You end up deflating the economy, which has already happened. And once an economy is deflated to again reflate mm-hmm. by just pumping in money, it doesn't happen so quickly. It takes
right.
time.
Right.
One can take an optimist view that the black money, once it enters the thing, things will again be hunky-dory. But it takes time. An economy has its way. It's not a homogeneous thing. I mean, there are different pockets of economy, different classes, different
right.
people adjust in different ways. It doesn't play out uniformly.
It doesn't play out in that way. So what happens to the fiscal deficit target then? I mean, the government did a lot last year in trying to bring down the deficit to 3.5%.
I think the
and that's where the market rally actually started. The market rally started because you had the deficit at 3.5. Now, if you're going to say all this, 3.5 looks 3 or whatever, 3.2 look also looks very difficult.
Well, IDS, they had a decent collection. It may mm-hmm. be slightly less than what they had thought, but
they got about 30. They'll take about 30,000 crore.
Divestment would be a problem.
Yes, but you know, my view
but ideas, is that ideas also, if you see the budget provision, is significantly less than that.
That's true. That is true. But my view on this is that I think this government has actually already missed the bus on disinvestment. You had a huge rally for about 6 months. You had about 2,000 point rally on the Nifty, and so many companies raised money through IPOs. So many companies raise money through, you know, QIPs, rights issues, the masala bond issues. Government hasn't done much. They've done a bit of buyback. I mean, buyback is not disinvestment. But in this market, if you're really going to go out and do disinvestment and you have a target of 60,000 crore, are you really going to meet that?
All governments are doing it for so many
time
that no
they seem to have missed the bus on that.
Always the case. They never come out on time, and most of this divestment happen at the last minute, maybe February, March, and end up with LIC buying it. So it's
right.
more like it is not a divestment in that sense. It is moving from one pocket to another.
Yeah.
As far as earnings are concerned, revenues are concerned, this government would have had no problem.
Mm.
I have no problem if a government says that I want to, that's a philosophical stand, that I want to curb illicit money.
Right.
It's fine.
Right.
But if it had handled the two amnesty or the quasi-amnesty schemes which have come,
right.
One is the Swiss bank, the foreign bank accounts, the black money scheme which came a year ago,
right.
And the recently IDS. Mm-hmm. If you see those schemes, the conditions, the strictures were absolutely discouraging.
Mm-hmm.
For instance, in the IDS scheme, mm-hmm. I mean, there was no immunity from indirect tax. In 97, when Chidambaram did his VDIS scheme, mm-hmm. initially there was no response. Then they inserted a thing that about indirect tax, that you will also get, because if you are a manufacturing concern,
right,
if you are surrendering this, even if you get an immunity from income tax, the indirect tax guys will come and attack you later.
Right, right.
So you give that immunity. In the foreign black money scheme, there were hundreds of conditions. They were asking for passbook since the time you opened the account. Now, who has 5-year-old passbook? I mean, it's silly.
Yeah, yeah. So we are now, what we are doing is, we are now talking about a kind of a magic bullet that the government has to use now to revive the economy, reflate it, bring back consumer confidence, bring back investor confidence. What can that magic bullet be? Can it be a big, you know, take some of the reserves from RBI, whatever they have done after extinguishing the currency? We don't know how long that process will be and whether any legislative changes are required, but that seems to be the only way out, isn't it? I mean, that's
the view on that is very unclear because it has never happened.
Absolutely, absolutely.
RBI has an accounting policy which is not the usual accounting standard.
Right.
So, an RBI we have traditionally seen has a mind of its own. It has resisted many government moves in the past. Whether it will continue to do that, one doesn't know. How this will play out, one really doesn't know.
But is governor also?
Well, I mean, that's jury is out. He's a very quiet person, so yeah. Possibly he will say something. His silence is almost killing a lot of people. But the thing is that the government will naturally claim that if a certain amount of money, say 1.5 lakh crore or 2 lakh crore, doesn't come back to the banking system,
mm-hmm.
in that case, it is an outcome of our action.
Government policy, that's right.
Outcome of government policy, and we have claim on that money.
Right.
So they can tell RBI, you better give us that money. We'll spend it the way we want.
That seems to be the argument from the government side.
That is, that seems to be the argument on a common corporate balance sheet handling. But the point is that RBI balance sheet is different from corporate balance sheet. When it's not, you create a liability and asset. Here you first buy an asset and then you print notes to create that liability. It's a different kind of a...
That's right.
Because RBI is the money creator, unlike a corporate.
So they'll have to do something, they'll have to figure a way out, maybe legislative change. I think Jetley or the finance ministry officials were mentioning that in that ET Now forum that they had on Friday. Maybe some kind of a legislative change, maybe some way whereby they can transfer the money.
You have to do a legislative change, otherwise you can't extinguish those notes.
You can't extinguish those notes.
Because the $50 note which UK government had demonetized, they didn't use the word demonetized, they were withdrawing.
Right.
In 2005 or about 10 years ago, if you go to UK, you can still exchange that note with Bank of England.
Right.
So it's still open. So that's why we ran a story that even though Prime Minister had said that all notes have to be declared by 31st March,
mm-hmm.
RBI notification has not given any last date.
That is true.
RBI has kept it open.
RBI has kept it open.
So
that is true.
That's been largely overlooked, but I don't know whether that's a subtle message from RBI.
So they have more time to do this, you mean?
Or they have time, but first they have to address the immediate pains. Immediate pains, they have to find out, is there any collateral damage mm-hmm. from this? Are people restless? Is there a discontent the way people are saying? Because media reports are diverse.
Absolutely.
Even RBI said that up to December 31st, you can deposit in banks.
Banks.
After that, RBI will take it.
RBI will take it.
After December 31st, it is not end. January, February, you can still submit with reason.
But I think it will be a little difficult to do that.
The Prime Minister in his speech said up to March 31st.
Mm.
But RBI in his notification said at a later date.
Okay.
They never said March 31st. Later date can be 5 years later.
Yeah. So magic bullet, Doc?
I think this is the only thing. Maybe government has to claim this, whatever the gains.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe 2 lakh, 3 lakh crore.
Right.
And then use it for, I think some, they may use it for some populist measures also. Because he has hurt a lot of his traditional vote banks.
He has hurt his traditional vote banks.
And he has to get this untraditional vote bank, maybe by doling out something, Narega, or maybe Jan Dhan account, put some money. That rumor is also there, I don't know how much it will happen.
10,000 rupees in Jan Dhan
account. Yeah, something like that. He can... get into that vote bank. See, that government has put two things. One is the vote. At the end of the day, we all want government to do only economic things, but they can't survive doing economic things.
No, of course.
Get the votes also. So that part also, maybe out of this, whatever the 3 lakh crore, he has to split between these two.
Great. You may not want to be a PSU banker now in all these circumstances.
Don't want to be a banker at all.
Nishant, your thoughts. Magic bullet from the government? Big spending on rural housing, Jan Dhan?
Yeah, so I mean, just one point that regarding the fiscal deficit target, sure. I think investors will forgive the government for deviating from that 3.5 or 3.8% target.
Sure.
Because worldwide governments are moving to fiscal stimulus now because they've seen that monetary stimulus is just not working.
Yeah.
So I think even if they, you know, even if they go to 4.2, I don't think
It is.
But they have no other option. They just have two more years left before the general elections.
Right.
They have to do something about and as I said before, you know, consumption is you don't know,
is
more or less killed.
It's going down.
What other option do they have?
Yeah.
You know, so I think, you know, the only thing over here is that the investors might forgive the government because of the global scenario.
Right. Let me just ask one point to all the three of you, and we are getting close to the question answer session, but this is a little removed from monetary economics and budget and all that stuff. How much do you think Modi's image has been hurt?
Has been hurt
by all this? The queues, the problems, the issues, the chaos, cash chaos?
I don't think it has been hurt.
You don't think it has been hurt?
But maybe if things persist further, as of now it just people are...
That's what people said last week also. If things persist further, it'll be a bit of a
problem.
We're going to be 2 weeks now.
Yeah, maybe another, don't know how much time it takes. It depends on how long this takes.
Right.
If it persists more, it will hurt. But as of now, I don't think it has been hurt.
It's not been hurt. Nishant?
No clue. Maybe, but I mean, you interact with a lot of people. They say that, you know, even within the markets, I mean, the funny part over here is that the market keeps talking about reforms and other things, you know, the bitter pill.
Right.
But this time when the bitter pill has actually come, a lot of people are actually bitter about it.
Right.
I mean, it's not that, you know, people are really happy. So.
Absolutely. They're not happy. I mean, there's a lot of chaos.
I'm not sure whether, you know, even many of the extremely pro-market guys, they are in favor of any more bitter pills now. So, I don't know. I mean, it's divided, I think.
Yeah, it depends also on where your money is. And is it in black or is it in white?
Yeah.
But one point about, one thing that has always been said about Modi's popularity is, at least that is the spin that is being put out, is that, well, the rural folk and the lower middle class and the slum dwellers, they all seem to be very happy.
Yeah.
Because this is something, you know, they never had much to do with the 1,000 rupee and the 500 rupee notes, and they never really had to stand in ATMs or use modern banking in the way that we do. And there is some, probably one may use the word vicarious pleasure in saying that, okay, set logon ka maal raddi ho gaya. Shubhato, your thoughts?
I don't think the image has been, there is a dent in the image. Mm-hmm. But the point is that people have got that shock. So there are two kinds of Modi supporters who will accept whatever he does.
Right.
I mean, who kind of...
the bhakts.
I mean, the bhakts will...
Sure.
The social media. But there's another kind of Modi supporters who had voted Modi for development, who were cheesed off with the earlier regime. As far as they are under concern, his image is under watch.
Image is under watch. That's a very nice word. That's a very nice phrase. Image under watch. And with that, we come to the end of this panel discussion. And can I just request audience questions? And I'd like you to, you know, state your name. And if there is a question that you would like to ask any of the panel members, please go ahead and ask them. Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
Mic?
I think there is a mic that's going to be going around.
Sir, no. I had one question. Yeah. So you said that consumption would decrease by 20%, but isn't it temporary? Because as in, if I am spending say X amount, and because of this demonetization, I have to spend Y amount, which is less than X. But won't it over appreciate when it normalizes? Won't I spend more? And won't it normalize? The curve is right now downwards, but won't it compensate for itself? So yeah. I don't really believe that consumption would go down 20%. It is just a temporary phase. That is what my opinion is. What is your take on that?
You're probably right. It also depends on how long you have to stand outside the ATM and how long you have to stand outside the bank queue. If you get enough money, probably you will end up spending in the nearby PVR complex. But let me ask, maybe Nishant can answer the
question. I'll take that. See, generally what economists say is that consumption normally, it's about confidence. Once your confidence is shattered, once you have, a certain amount of money with you, you have that confidence to spend. Now, let's say that a lot of the informal economy, once it takes a hit, you have lesser money at your disposal. You know, that confidence takes a hit and you probably delay your purchases. So that is the logic where these guys are coming from, that consumption will be hit. But really, people really don't know, maybe will it be for one quarter, two quarters, or maybe even four quarters. It's about the confidence. It's nothing more than that.
We are all hoping that you are right, that we don't have to suffer long.
Yeah. Ma'am.
All right, so I had a couple of quick comments, not really questions per se, but comments basically on some of the things that you've been saying. So you were talking about the monetary policy review, which is going to happen in December, on the 7th of December.
Fifth or seventh.
So we see that the call money rate has already come down. It's 6.05 compared to the repo rate of 6.25. So you could expect the policy rates to be cut. But my question is this: how does it really help the large informal sector, which depends on the money lenders, the 58% of the unbanked segment, in the kind of lack of credit which is available? They are really going to be paying much, much larger interest rates. So if you're looking at the transmission mechanism also, we know that the transmission mechanism is not really perfect. So this entire thing of, corporate India feeling good about rates of interest coming down is not really going to work. The other kind of a thing that I wanted to tell you from the market side is that when your bond yields have been going down in India, right? You have your bond yields going up in the rest of the world. In all the emerging markets, there's been a 30% rise in the bond yields in the last month.
Yeah.
In Turkey, it's 85%, 69% in Brazil, and so on, right? So what's really going to happen to our CAD, and what's going to happen to the financing of the CAD? These are kind of things that we didn't hear you speak about, right? And the other kind of thing that I would like to tell you also is that we're looking at much of these deposits coming in as CASA deposits. You're not really going to be able to lend out with this. And not only that, it's going to affect your capital adequacy ratios as well.
Right, absolutely.
So yeah. Those are things that I think we need to touch upon. And just a final point, a quick point on the fiscal deficit. You were talking about the disinvestment targets. I seem to have these targets out here. Sorry, there's a phone out here. So we had something like 312 crore rupees was our revised estimate for 2015-16 after a 69,500 budget estimate. We have got it up again to 56,500. And where are the disinvestment targets going to be achieved given that you have a February 1 budget date?
It's probably not going to.
It's not going to happen. Your corporate income taxes, so your fiscal deficit. There have been some sections of the press saying that it's going to have a huge positive impact on fiscal deficit coming down. I mean, I completely support what you people have been saying, but these are things which the government doesn't seem to have planned through. And then the whole rational expectations hypothesis, I think nobody in the government really seems to be getting some academic advice.
You're right. No, that's the surprising part. The markets have been doing well for most of the financial year, and the government just has been indifferent to, it could have easily divested a lot of their...
Absolutely.
That's absolutely.
Even the unbanked, as you said.
Yeah.
one of the sectors which have been badly hit, I hope it's temporary, is the microfinance sector.
Absolutely.
Because microfinance sector, the moment collections stop, disbursement also stops.
Yeah.
That is the thing.
Yeah.
Now, gold loans, that is loan against gold. Now, these sectors, I mean, the access to credit, just lowering the repo rate or the reverse repo rate doesn't really help.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree doesn't. More that, with that's you. What precisely I'm
In saying. Fact, yeah. even as we talk, we don't, I mean, there has been a news a few hours ago. They've relaxed the regulations, the NPA norms.
NPA norms.
For the small, for the I think 1 crore.
1 crore. 1 crore is a limit.
So it's a recognition that the small businessman would be badly hit.
Yeah.
That is true. You want to talk about the point on CASA deposits?
Yeah, that is there. I mean, as I said, that by 30th December, we'll get a fair assessment that how much is moving to time liability, how much is moving to demand liability.
Right.
Then only the banks can price their loans and come out with the products.
Right.
Yeah, most of this thing either will move out. People, once this restriction goes, people will withdraw or shift to most as an FD or something. Nobody is going to keep it in the savings account.
Nobody is going to keep it.
This is the first land of investment.
There are also people saying that you can use this for your infrastructure financing.
No, that cannot be used. That is a.
Well, what can probably be used for infrastructure financing if they find a way to transfer the reserves from RBI to the government?
That is of the money not got in. What the money get in, assume that out of 15 lakh, 12 lakhs got in, that cannot be used. That is someone else's money.
No, one of the television channels even asked the State Bank chairman, the chairperson, that the money that is coming in, would you be using that to offset your NPS? It's like, she didn't know, she was bristling.
That is someone else's money.
Sorry, if can I just, we got some fair bit of questions on Twitter also. So if I could just ask one or two questions and then I'll come back to you, if that's all right. Yeah. So Nishant, you're a popular guy, so there's a question directed at you. What kind of significant announcements and budget are we talking about? This is from Mr. Chandresh. He's asked this question on Twitter. So some of the points you've gone over, maybe you can just talk about.
I mean, I don't have any specifics. I mean, nobody will have those kind of specifics. But the key is going to be, again, it is going to be infrastructure spending. Yeah, I mean, that is going to be the main thing.
Okay, there is another question from Mr. Somraj. Will this decrease inflation in the short term? If yes, will this affect our bank deposits due to rate cut?
Well, inflation in the very short term, it may decrease because people don't have the money to spend.
Right.
In the medium term, we don't know what happens to the rabi crop, whether food inflation goes down, manufacturing inflation comes down.
Yeah.
I don't know where it will play out. In the medium term, in the next 2 quarters, if growth falls, consumption suffers, inflation will not go up possibly.
Inflation will not.
Demand is going to be hit. So demand from that point of view, yes. Sure.
Sorry, sir. It's all yours.
Myself, Gopal Pansari, I just wanted to inform who's stopping the consumption, because consumption as that fellow told, it's a short term, I think. Because once the money comes in the system, anybody can spend by plastic card or by the check or by the internet banking. And the person who were having the black money, they might be having the good amount of the white money as well. So they may spend by online and the things.
That what you're saying is correct, basically on logistics wise. But there is two things. One is basically with regard to this wealth effect. So out of this, we are talking of the Kaladhan going out. It is still there. So for somebody sitting on a huge pile of notes and becoming raddi and he was not able to deposit, it's a huge hit on his consumption.
They are definitely having their white money as well.
No, they have so white money. He will not spend that white spending. Money. He will not spend that white money because he has already personal hit.
No,
so
no.
That wealth effect impact, suddenly I'm losing my wealth significantly. My consumption will come down. So the consumption will be two types. One is the basic consumption, that will continue. Nobody is talking of that. But high-end consumption, especially with regard to very high-end vehicles and things like that will take a hit. That is going to be more permanent hit. That is not going to be a short-term hit. The normal consumption will be short-term hit and next quarter itself it will pick up. But this high-end consumption will take a permanent hit, at least for a year.
So basically there will be a transition period from now to when people move more and more towards digital. That's going to take a bit of time. It's not obviously, it's already started happening, but for it to really take off in a big way. It'll take about a couple of months. Now, the second point is that in the rural areas where cash is used a lot, now obviously people are hoarding cash, right? I mean, you don't see, get to see too many 100 rupee notes even here. So people are obviously going to hoard cash, and for the next, say, month or two, it's probably not going to manifest in any major consumption. And we are only assuming that this problem will be there only for a month. What if it's there, spills over into Jan? There is going to be, there's also a psychological issue. And it's not going to be so simple for consumption to be a V-shaped, take a V-shaped recovery. It'll happen. I'm not saying it'll not happen. It'll take a bit of time.
And what about the person who were involved in the chit fund investment and all, because they were not knowing the banking facilities, but now under pressure, they are using the banking facility. So I think this chit fund scam will
chit
go
fund
down.
Scan.
Yes, I mean, a lot of that informal money may come in. Some of that informal money may come in.
I think chit fund is not a scam in that sense.
It is
so
not a
you
scam.
Need to explain that.
Yes.
Except if you're talking about Sharda.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yes.
My name is Harshad Shah. Just taking the question on the rural economy and rural public, there seems to be, I think, very less knowledge about this currency part in the rural part, because the information has not been percolated down or it's not been understood even by a lot of people who are not even educated. Why I'm saying this, because I happen to visit some of the Mapuzal area. A lot of these real estate people are buying huge chunk of agricultural land by paying a cash. And these people, without even understanding, they are selling their land.
In recent times, you mean?
Recent time, I'm talking last week.
Last week.
And they're paying, and they're paying old notes.
They are paying old notes. They are collecting old notes. They don't know what to do with that. And that means this information has not percolated down, or percolated down but not understood by them. So what does... How does the media play a role where this common man, the farmers, the rural public come to know what is the implication of this particular move that the government has made? Because they are today sitting on a chunk of huge cash with them.
Which can't be used.
Which may not be able to, because once they deposit in the bank, they will not be able to explain it to the tax authorities.
Money is not a legal tender. Will that transaction will be a valid?
Sure. Just come again.
My question, if the 1,000 rupees and 500 rupees are not the legal tender after 8th of this month, will these transactions will be valid?
Technically, no.
Then they will not be losing anything.
They would have signed the papers and they wouldn't have...
They signed old stamp papers. They are not even registered deeds. They are just, old stamp paper. They use it. They pay cash because anything about 20,000 rupees, they can't, above 50,000 rupees, they can't pay by cash. They have to pay by check. Yeah. So these real estate people are taking this, rural folks for a ride.
That's very unfortunate. Yeah. We don't know how widespread this is, but these are the pitfalls of this kind of moves.
Sudden moves.
If you share us the details, maybe we can send one of our reporters to cover it.
And another thing which is hurting them is the cooperative banks are dysfunctional now, which That's is right. mainly in the rural area.
The rural cooperative.
So rural cooperative banks is totally dysfunctional because RBI has not included them for exchange
right.
of currency
That's
and all.
Right.
So the rural economy has still not felt the pinch of this particular move. And we don't know how next, 30-40 days, how it is going to play out in a rural economy.
It's going to be bad until and unless cash reaches every corner of the
country. I don't
know
whether the government or the decision makers are even aware about, because India lives 70% in the rural area.
No, that's true.
Now, for instance, I think they have allowed use of old notes to purchase, for the seeds and...
Seeds. That's right. They've just allowed it today.
So what happens to fertilizers? They should be allowed. So I won't be surprised, as you said, because of this distress. There could be more such relaxations so that they can tide over the cash crunch.
Possible. They may probably be considering some relaxation in the case of...
Because the banking has not spread to many of these areas. That's some true. Of these places, 10 lakh rupees, 10 lakh population, one bank.
Right. No, absolutely. You're right.
I wanted to ask the panel that it is being said that the luxury sector, jewelry sector, or the real estate sector will have a downfall starting from next year onwards. So is that downfall short term or long term? Because it is being said that it will be short term if cash again flows into the market, or it might be long term effect if a government takes out some other reforms and the money will not be generated again. So is it short term or long term?
The downfall. No, but what period are you mentioning? Short term?
Like short term in terms of 1 year, then the coming 1 year. So is it like downfall for 1 year or more than that?
See, many of the luxury retail chains, my colleagues say that sales are already down 30 to 50%.
Yeah.
Okay. So next maybe one or two quarters, they are expecting a similar kind of an impact. So I mean, you might have your cards and other things, but the fact is that most of the spending that happens still happens via cash.
Yeah.
So the downfall is temporary,
or it might move more long, like the downfall, like the down in sales or something. They can't
you
be
never
said.
Know.
Right.
Yeah, of course.
We welcome two quarters.
I mean, there is a unanimity among the economists that two quarters there could be a shortage.
Okay.
There could be a slowdown. After that, if other things remain the same, we'll see an uptick. But then we don't know. The jury is out. At time, you don't know the downside risks. There are so many imponderables. It's a volatile world. No? What happens 2 years, two quarters later?
Okay. Right. Thank you, sir.
Absolutely. Some more questions from Twitter, then we'll just go back to the audience. Question from Mr. G. Jagannathan. How will the government give confidence that demonetization is a continuous process and no black money or hoarding will be accepted? Doc, you want to take that? How will the government give confidence that demonetization is a continuous process and no black money or hoarding will be accepted?
I mean, Mr. Jagannathan is expecting a demonetization every two years.
this is not something government can do it on a regular basis. We had it in 78,
right,
when Morarji Desai was the Prime Minister, and it's happening after so many years. We cannot do it on a regular basis. So sure.
One more question from Mr. Mathur. What else can be done by RBI government bank to reduce the cash crunch pressure on banks? They've been doing quite a bit. Anything more that you think should be done?
As they did the NPA relaxation.
Right.
I won't be surprised if more such regulatory relaxations come. Because if there is a slowdown in business, mm-hmm, to support growth, whatever the regulatory requirements, other than raising the interest rate, because interest rate, one can say that everything is a function of price. If interest rate falls, two-wheeler demand, this, that will happen. But the regulator also has to relax certain norms. I mean, if the business is slow, you can't ask the guy to pay your loan on time.
No, absolutely.
So those relaxations, I expect more to come.
Okay. Any more questions from the audience?
Good evening, sir. I am Naveel. And my question is, do you think that introducing 2000 note will depreciate Indian rupee in long term, because stronger currencies do not have notes of higher denomination?
Okay, that's a good point. There is a similar question. Why launch the 2000 rupee note, which I think you were talking about earlier?
Yeah.
So maybe you want to.
Government might have introduced it for reducing this short time pain. If it's a 100 rupee note pain, short time pain, I'm talking.
Right.
About, would have been more. And whether you have 2000 rupee notes or 1000 rupee notes, it is not going to impact the value of the currency. Because that currency strength is nothing to do with the denomination of the currency.
Thank you, sir.
But one thing I'll just add to you, this I need to cross-check, but what little I know is that the value, the percentage of high denomination notes was much higher in India than compared to other countries. In fact, within RBI, this has been discussed in the last few years, but the banks have been asking for high denomination notes, either because cash demand was going up, either because of inflation or for other reasons. They were asking for 500, 1000 rupee and all that. It's almost 86%, which is
86%
is abnormal now.
Yeah.
Which is really abnormal.
Actually, last
and this cash demand has been surging in the last few years, particularly from 13, 14 onwards. So we saw a sudden surge of such high denomination notes in the market. Yes, sir.
Actually, you're right. In the last 10 years, it has come down from, say, 85% to about 15-18%. The share of low denomination currencies.
Right.
Yes, I see there's a negative sentiment about the impact of demonetization. in this panel. Suppose we say that it works. What would be the quantifiable measure? One measure that you talked about is how much of this 500 and 1,000 rupee notes come back, and what percent of the if the total money circulation that has come back. What are the other quantifiable measures to say that it has worked or not worked in, say, next two quarters or till the 31st May and beyond? Okay. And how do you measure this? You say that demonetization work. What is a measure for that?
Okay, let me take this and then maybe the other panel members can join. Demonetization, you have to look at it as a part of a broader, I mean, it can only work if it is a part of a broader plan. If it is a part of a broader battle or a war to combat black money, on its own, it can never work. You know, as one of my colleagues pointed out, I mean, once this hula hoo is over, you'll have the high denomination notes back in the market and the 2,000 rupee notes will be laundered again. Now, unless and until you bring in more measures to tackle black money. See, why was demonetization done? Because of black money. Because to eradicate black money. Unless and until you have more such measures, whether it's to do with Benami property, whether it's to do with curbing cash transactions, whether it's to do with going after people who have undeclared wealth in foreign bank accounts, this will just peter out and just fade away.
Given that all other measures would not be so painful or common, this one is.
Right.
There has to be a return.
Quantifiable success.
Quantifiable success.
No, first of all, I'd like to tell you, I mean, when you say negative sentiment across the panel, we can't deny it, but what we are doing, we are voicing the fears, the sentiment. We all want it to succeed because otherwise we'll all suffer. I mean, we won't get salary hikes, we won't get kind of. So the point is two things. I think immediately on 30th December, you will get to know how much money comes back into the banking system. Now take two, three scenarios. If out of this 15 lakh crore, suppose if 14 and a half lakh crore comes back into the banking system, then it's a comedy of absurd. Then people will say that was it all white tax-paid money people were holding, now they've given it back?
Yeah.
Or are people willingly paying and facing the income tax? Or people have laundered money? So that will be a curious situation. Suppose 1.5 lakh crore, 2 lakh crore does not come back in the banking system. The government can say that, look, this much money has entered the banking system, which is a great thing, it was lying outside. Banking has entered the formal sector, and this 2 lakh crore was really the bad money, was the black money.
Is there anything apart from this?
In the immediate thing?
No.
Not in the next 6 months. Is there a way to measure this?
One is tax collection. One is tax collection. If the government can show somehow that they're using the black money, the impounded money to raise expenditure.
Just the direct cash collection,
yes.
Right?
Yeah, just the
direct cash collection.
Yeah.
Correct.
It will be only these two. One is the total money not coming into the banking system. That government can say that much black money has gone out. Another is the increase in tax collection. Because even if some of this money comes
and the
in,
other, and the other
out
thing
of this
is
thing,
the
some money tax will come. So the tax collection, something they can. I'm talking the direct tax collection, income tax only.
And the amount of card spent. If you see the amount of card spent going up, then even if the government does not succeed in taxing this money, but if this card spends goes up, then it's a significant demonstration that a lot of things is...
We move more and more into a digital
into a cashless economy.
Kind of
that would be a...
It's a government which is the biggest discourager of cash spend, right? Railways, electricity, everywhere you have to pay this 2%, 3% transaction.
You're right. I mean, at least for debit card, it should be... there shouldn't be any charge. It would be a minuscule charge.
Actually, there is a related question again that's come online from Mr. Rajesh Dixit. Why have a transaction fee on card payments? Why not tax cash transactions instead?
Yeah. Because when you are buying a 5 lakh jewelry, that 2% hurts, not when you are buying groceries.
Hi, I'm Shirish. I just wanted to ask a related question on the denting of Modi's image. We are hearing in the media that the biggest supporter of Narendra Modi were the traders. And all of them are now switching allegiance to Shiv Sena and other parties. Do you see that as a significant trend? Because that is a political fallout. I mean, he came to power on a thumping majority based on the very segment who is sort of getting hurt right now, if I may say so.
But okay, you know, I'll take this. You're probably only, partially right when you say that he came to power on the basis of traders' support. He didn't come to power on the basis of traders' support. Sure, he got their money and he got their support, and there are pockets of the country where he probably won with the traders and the jewelers and the traditional BJP supporting class. But he came to power largely on the view on the support of a large number of, you know, middle class professionals, farmers, deprived people in villages. You look at the kind of support that he got. I mean, he wouldn't have won 71 out of 80 seats in UP with just trader support. If it was just the Brahmin stroke Baniya community supporting him, he wouldn't have won in Bihar, or he wouldn't have swept all those seats in Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan and all that. Going forward, what will be the impact on the trade? Yes, there are a lot of people who are probably hurt, and you are probably right that some of them will switch allegiance to the Shiv Sena or to some other party. But will they switch allegiance totally? I'm not so sure. I'm willing to be convinced otherwise, but I'm not so sure based on whatever anecdotal evidence one has heard. And again, is it big enough to impact a complete change in electoral fortunes, given the fact that he has completely transformed? You know, the BJP as a party has transformed itself. It's no longer a Brahmin, Baniya, traders party anymore. At least it doesn't get support from there, maybe just financial support. It's become more a party of the OBCs, which is now trying to reach out to the Dalits. It's become a party of, it's in a way where the Congress was probably, or in the, you know, 60s and 70s, it's trying to get there. So you're partially right. Yes, there would be a move. A lot of people are very angry. There is no doubt about that. But whether it'll be alone enough to hurt his electoral fortunes, I'm not so sure.
Because the first 2 weeks, if you look at APMC, for example.
Right.
You mean to say that election?
They have lost big time.
I mean, none of us should be very sure that 1 week later you will get your onions and tomatoes, because you don't know where they are and whether they are going to land up in the friendly neighborhood grocery store or not. Because how is it going to move? We are all living on the 2 week or the 3 week inventory of all these essentials. Please remember that.
Yeah.
There was a, just as all of us had cash at home, there was some stock floating around in the market. How is it going to move? A lot of those things are, and it's hurting the whole common man, the whole cycle of trader, common man, his customer, his customer's customer, his supplier, and that entire value chain is being hurt.
So that is probably where the biggest hurt or the biggest impact will come from. Not just the traders, but also if the common man suffering continues.
Yeah.
I think Doc was talking about whether it goes into 2 to 3 weeks.
Something like we started with this gamble itself. So Modi is taking a much bigger gamble. He know that his traditional traders and these people will get hurt and they will be angry, and he thinks that he can compensate with the non-traditional voters. Maybe the Aam Janta, he is expecting that. Some of the tweets I have doing with that, some of the traditional AAP supporters, something like AAP Pune and all, they are supporting it. So a lot of people who are against Modi till time has started supporting. Some of the hardcore supporters have gone around. So
it's
story happening both ways.
It's not a story which is unfolding. It's a very interesting thing. As we began the discussion, I said that a demonetization of this magnitude, you're exposing yourself to one of the risks is a political risk. How it plays out.
Yeah, and how it will play out, we'll see later, because whether it is he is able to get more votes than the votes he lose.
Hello, sir. This is Antariksh here.
Yeah.
So my question is specifically to Ramnathan, sir. He said that black money is primarily composed of three components. One is cash, there is real estate, and there is gold.
Yeah.
So after cash, do you see any big bang reforms in the real estate sector or any other rules on the gold sector, like suppose abolition of stamp duties or perhaps state fighting of election or something of that sort? And if that does not happen, then do you see the parallel economy again factoring in this demonetization scheme, and then, you know, gold prices being jacked up in the future or land being bought, as the gentleman over there pointed out? So the shadow economy will perhaps not vanish, but will modify itself in the future if the reforms
are factored. Yeah, see, as of now, government is planning something, so we don't know what kind of action they will take, but some action is expected on that. Maybe ask people to declare the gold holding they have. There may not be a restriction on how much gold one can hold, but ask them to declare it as part of our income tax. As of now, we are not doing it. Or there may be a restriction on how much the land one can hold. There will be some action, especially on Benami. Maybe ask everybody to come to the register office and certify KYC once again. So that kind
yeah.
of a thing.
Yeah.
There will be some
limitation
action
on cash transaction. Eh? Limitation on cash transaction.
Limitation on cash transaction, understand that I have some doubt on that. Even now, cash transaction is not allowed.
No, it is allowed. And as long as you give your PAN number, it is allowed.
Which is that aspect?
Jewelers yeah, accept allowed. Cash. I mean, if you, that way.
But they're planning to put a, I mean, there is a talk. They're planning to put a cap. Or
yeah, but even say, for example, that somebody is buying a 1 crore worth of real estate, 60% black. That anyway is outside the system.
No, that is there. But suppose
you cannot ban it no. by banning cash transactions.
Sure.
So that is
no, sure. that there you are not showing the value. Mm. But suppose you are buying a 5 lakh jewelry, you are paying 5 lakh cash.
Yeah, that you can.
You are not violating the law of the land. But today, if they say you can't transact any cash transaction beyond 3 lakh, then you are breaking the law if you do that. So after this kind of a thing, then people may be a little more. So that could be one way. Yes, you are right. I mean. For future generation of black money, one has to...
See, we're running out of time. Sir. We'll just have... sorry. Can I just come back to you in 2 minutes? I'll just have a bit of online questions and I'll just come back. There's a question from Mr. Sanu. Aren't we a little too early for a cashless economy? Majority population not knowing what debit card is and what credit card is. So it brings us to the same point that we were discussing, that you made... You went into this move a little aggressively, not factoring in a lot of things. You think... I mean, what is the view on the panel? Do we think that cashless economy is now going to take off in a big way?
It is going to take off, but not in a big way. It will take time.
It will take time.
In urban areas, it will. I think it has received some push.
Right.
In the smaller towns, rural areas, it will take longer, much longer.
Right, right. And are we moving towards, this is from Mr. Nikunj on Twitter, are we moving towards a banking transaction tax?
No, I don't think so.
No, you don't think so?
Well, this is a thing which is doing the rounds, whether income tax would be lowered and indirect tax would be raised.
Right.
Because this is, I think, one of the suggestions of the NGO which has given the, not the NGO, the group which has given the suggestion of scrapping black money.
Yeah.
I don't know. This would be retrograde because internationally we have higher income tax and lower, higher indirect tax would be unfair.
So this is an interesting question. Mr. Anup, was cleaning out NPA is also a motive of demonetization? Okay, sorry. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. You said earlier that eventually as time passes by, the black money would be converted into new currency of higher denomination, say 2000 rupee notes, and it would come into circulation and again black money would be generated. But the existing black money that we already have is already, people who hold black money would hold that in currencies of higher denomination, say 500 and 1000. Since now the government has banned the 500 and 1000 currency notes, people who will exchange those notes and who will deposit that money into the bank, the money will be come into the banking system and will be accounted for. So after that, how do you see that the money will black money will be generated after that?
Yeah, black money generation happens with several things. Sir. Maybe somebody is taking a bribe, he's taking in black only. Somebody selling a house and not showing it full.
But
that is again black only. And black money generation will continue if government doesn't take other measures to curb it.
But once you see that the money enters the accounting system,
no,
the banking
system.
This
is what you are talking of, the current black money get cleaned. But if the government doesn't take measures, then new black money will start generating again.
But how will money enter the current into the banking system if you are not declaring it?
Yeah, that is a different issue. But people who will declare, people who declare their income and who they claim they had black money and they submitted their money into the banks.
No,
that money
not
would...
now. That period is over.
We don't
that
know.
That is that earlier amnesty scheme which was there till September 30. Now you cannot declare that I had this much black money.
That is so over. That
you have to declare it as a part of your income
but
and then pay
people,
tax on it.
People who will now deposit their money, if there is no questioning on that, so...
No, there is questioning.
There is questioning and government has already started sending out notices.
So if you
even somebody putting 4.5 lakh, government has started putting notices. If you put some 40 lakh, definitely notice will come. It is not going to go like that.
Well, you have some serious cash to handle, I mean.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, great. So that brings us to the end of the question answer session, except there is one question which kind of intrigued, is a little intriguing. It just fits in also with, it's from Mr. Ashish. Was demonetization planned long back to club back money, black money starting with Jan Dhan Yojana? There seems to be a bit of a pattern in this.
Yeah, there is a clear pattern.
Clear
first
pattern.
First you started with Jan Dhan Yojana.
Jan
and then coming out with amnesty scheme,
right,
and then starting with this. So there is a clear pattern. Even when the amnesty scheme was on, Modi and even Jaitley was on TV telling several times, at least 10 times, saying that we are going to come out with harsh measures. He did not mention what measure.
Correct.
So it was clear. It was clear.
There was a clear pattern to it. Okay. One last question. One, please.
That there is, we have the pain and the gain. Pain is the demonetization, gain is the black money. How much it has is going to be achieved, we are very uncertain. Now, all the discussions we have heard, that is this the right time Modi has done it, or he should have had more risk management system in place before having done it. Now, four of you, if I ask you, you are Mr. Modi, would you have done it at this time, individually?
Okay, you are asking us. Yeah, we'll kind of go around and
starting from here.
I wouldn't have done it at all.
GST is supposed to be implemented from April.
Yeah.
Both these things combined together.
Yeah.
Yep, I wouldn't have done it at all.
Doc?
Yeah, I would have done it. Only thing that...
You better do it because you have written about it. You don't have a way.
See, my only thing is with the lack of availability of notes. Otherwise, I don't have an issue with
it. You would have done it. Okay, Nishant?
Yeah, probably yes. Yeah.
Probably yes, you would have done it. I would have done it, sir.
You know?
I would have done it.
At this time, or you would have...
No, you mean the timing?
I would have done.
Not at this juncture, no. Not now, not now.
We really running out of time.
Would he have done...
Just one short one.
30 seconds. Considering Rabi Sohan and the wedding season...
You're right.
Was it the right time?
It was.
No, that wedding season is especially with the... We have a very wide country. And for some period, some part it is one wedding season, and for some other season, it is another wedding season. You can have it.
Okay. Thank you. You guys have been really wonderful. Closing comments from all the panel members. Naren, if we can just start with you. Are we going to be in a recession next year?
that we need to wait till at least till end of this December to see.
You will wait till the end of December 15th. But what is your best guess?
Definitely, we are going to take a hit.
You're going to take
a hit. As of now, it looks like 1% GDP growth is coming down.
Okay, you're hedging your bets.
And if it prolong, it may be more than 1% also. I'm talking not negative, I'm talking about the growth. If it have grown at 7%, it will be 6%.
It'll be great. Nishant, too much of doomsaying out here, too much of negative things. I mean, are we really going to bounce back, V-shaped recovery? You think?
V-shape or U-shape, I'm not sure, but yeah, there is some pain. I mean, it's difficult to really project what is going to happen now.
What is going to happen? Yeah. Okay, Sugato, if I can ask you a different question. 2019, you think Modi will win? You think he will?
Yes. But half a point decline in, half a point dip in growth and volatile markets, that's what I feel.
Volatile, half a point decline in growth, volatile markets. So the consensus on the panel seems to be that it's a good decision, bold, brave decision, but done at the wrong time, very poor planning, and we are probably headed into some kind of slowdown.
No, you saw the nature of the debate among the opposition.
Yeah.
Comparing this with Uri and all that thing. Modi can just...
He can walk over.
He has a political risk.
Yeah, he can walk over. So, but probably by... If you have a similar debate or a discussion sometime next year, we'll probably be doing it in a different climate, maybe in a different environment. Maybe the markets will be back at 30,000, Nishant? On that bright, cheerful note, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for a wonderful evening. You've been a great audience.